Hi, let's talk about the kidneys. So the kidneys, interestingly enough, as they're described by many anatomical textbooks, are kidney bean-shaped structures, as tautological as that may sound. They have both superior and inferior poles. Remember, the superior pole is generally around level, vertebral level T11, and the inferior pole around L1. There are also convex lateral borders and a concave medial border for the kidney, which hosts the hilum, or the area for the neurovasculature to enter and exit the kidney. The parenchyma, or the physiologically active tissues of the kidney, is divided between the cortex and the medulla. The cortex is found in the most superficial layer of the kidney, and it also invaginates amongst the medulla as columns. So everything that's outlined there in green would be the cortex. The medulla sits nestled amongst the cortex, and it's often referred to as the renal pyramids. And this is probably a bad name for it, because when you take into account the three-dimensionality of the medulla, it's actually shaped like a cone rather than a pyramid. Now, it's between these layers, the cortex and the medulla, that we have the nephrons, which are the fundamental unit physiologically of the kidney. So that's where they're working to filter the blood. Now, urine is conducted down collecting ducts that go through the medulla and end at the renal papillae. And so what I'm outlining now are the renal papillae. And these renal papillae are surrounded by areas called minor calyces. These minor calyces are receiving the urine from the collecting ducts. And then that urine flows from the minor calyces into the major calyces. And generally, kidneys have 2 to 3 major calyces. And then the major calyces coalesce into the renal pelvis. And then the renal pelvis feeds into the ureter. Now, one thing to keep in mind is that these spaces are always illustrated as open or patent places. In vivo, in life, these are actually collapsed in on themselves. So they're not very large, unless they're replete or full of urine that's backed up. And so it's probably useful to conceptualize these spaces to learn them as open, but they're actually closed. Now, when we look at the parenchyma on a cadaveric specimen such as this one, we see that the distinctions between the cortex and the medulla can oftentimes be very difficult to see post-preservation. So here we can see cortex, and we can see some cortex there and there and there. And these dark areas are medulla. We can see a renal papilla there. We can see another renal papilla there as well. Now, the urine that's being conducted first goes into these minor calyces, and you have a better idea here. You can see precisely how narrow these minor calyces can be. They're very small and collapsed in on themselves, and then they feed into major calyces, which are a little bigger, and then finally into the renal pelvis, which on the cadaveric specimen here, you can see really isn't that large of a space before finally draining into the ureter on the way down to the urinary bladder. The kidneys are, for many of our dissections, dissections of opportunity, meaning that in order to reach them, you really anteriorly have to go through most of the GI, or the digestive system. Now, there are a couple of basic relationships of the kidneys that we should understand. So first of all, just anterior to the kidneys is going to be the retroperitoneal membrane, which I'll explain on the next slide, but just immediately anterior to that is going to be the duodenum. And in the crook of the duodenum, we can see the pancreas here. And let me outline so that you can see the kidneys right there and there. So we have the duodenum and the pancreas lying anterior to the kidneys. Superior to the left kidney, we have the spleen, and inferior to it would be the splenic flexure of the transverse colon. For the right kidney, there's actually a rather large liver, which is why the right kidney is usually inferiorly displaced with respect to the level of the left kidney. And we also have the hepatic flexure of the transverse colon. So these flexures of the transverse colon are generally named for approximately what's superior to them: splenic on the left side and hepatic on the right side. So now we have an idea of what's going on in the vicinity of the kidneys. Now the kidneys join other structures such as the aorta, the inferior vena cava, the lion's share of the pancreas, portions of the duodenum, as being retroperitoneal structures. Now, the peritoneum is a topic that's addressed within the context of the digestive system, but very quickly, it's a membrane that lines the abdominal pelvic cavity and the viscera contained within that cavity. So there's parietal peritoneum on the body wall, and then there's visceral peritoneum on the organs themselves. Certain organs are going to be posterior to the parietal peritoneum in what we call the retroperitoneal space. So here you can see a kidney that's been dissected partially, and there's still some peritoneum in front of this kidney. Now, deep to that parietal peritoneum would be a variable amount of para with an A, renal fat. And then deep to that para renal fat would be the renal fascia, sometimes referred to as the perirenal fascia. Deep to that renal fascia is the perirenal fat with an I, and I remember I because it's on the inside of the fascia. And that's the fat that's really going to encase the kidney and hold it firm within the perirenal gutter. That perirenal fat can sometimes even invade the hilum of the kidney, and it poses no real harm to the kidney itself. It's just there. So when we think about the layers that surround the kidney, anteriorly we have the parietal peritoneum, then that's encasing the pararenal fat, which invests around the renal fascia, which surrounds the perirenal fat. So we've talked about the anatomy of these dynamic filters and some of the parts of the kidneys and how they relate to other structures in the abdominal cavity. Thank you.